Hello malt friends and happy new year. I hope you had a great start into the new year. I'm more than happy to welcome you to the New West Whisky Amateur Class episode where I'm going to do a summary of the first 10 episodes. So this now is going to be very, you're gonna hear a lot of information. It might be a bit overwhelming for you. So take your time and watch the video several times if you need to. So yeah, I'm trying to do this as informative as possible. So I'm using also a cheat sheet today in order to not to forget anything. And I might even cut the video here and there so that it is as short as possible. So when I started this channel back in July or August, I had two main goals. So first of all, I wanted to record my journey in the world of whiskies. And second, I would like to educate complete beginners. So this channel is mostly for my close friends and family, but in the meantime, also some other people have started to follow this channel. So I'm more than happy to say that I am close to 100 subscribers, and this is roughly what I was expecting. And one more aspect of this channel is that it is bilingual. So I am always providing Hungarian subtitles so that also people home where I come from can tune in who cannot speak English. And yeah, so this channel is mostly for beginners. And since I've been doing also whisky reviews with whiskies that are not that, they are not really for beginners, I hope that also connoisseurs or other whiskey lovers will enjoy some of my content. So a couple of words about myself, some credentials. As of today, I've tasted 144 different whiskies, and that from over 50 different distilleries. And I've attended roughly 10 tastings in the past 3 years. Those were mostly in-person tastings, but I also attended some online events. I also organized myself 2 different private tasting events, and I also took part in an online course, in an online whiskey course. So yeah, now let me begin by summarizing the content of my videos. So the videos 1, 2, and 3, that was meant as an introduction, and there I've started to talk about, you know, the very basics. How do you spell whiskey, for example? Do you write it with an E or without an E? Actually, both is correct. Depending where you are or in which region the whiskey is produced, you might write it without an E, for example, in Scotland, but if you are in the US or in Ireland, you will write it as whiskey, so with an E. The origins date back to the 14th century, roughly. The first written mention of Scottish whiskey is from 1494. And there are 5 big whiskey nations, so Scotland, Ireland, the US, Canada, and Japan. And in Scotland, that's the region where I'm focusing on. In Scotland, you have 5 different whiskey regions. So you have the Highlands, including the Islands region, Lowland, Speyside, Campbelltown, and Islay. They have different characteristics. So it does make a difference where the whiskey is produced, because they will have a slightly different style, or sometimes not just slightly. Let's see a quick definition of whiskey. What is whiskey in the first place? If I asked you this question, would you be able to tell me? So here is a very, very simple definition: that whiskey is alcohol distilled from a cereal base mash that is matured in wooden casks. So you already see from the definition that whiskey is a pretty complex product. And the main ingredients, as you can see from this definition, is grain, yeast, water, and oak. So the first and most important one, grain. What is grain in the first place? So grain is like, you know, that sums up. And below grain, you have barley, corn, rye, wheat, and other more exotic grain types. But I don't want to talk about that because that's a really niche segment. Depending where you produce the whiskey and what kind of grain you use, it is going to have a different name. So for example, when I say single malt, that means that it's from one single distillery and it's from malted barley. So that's very typical for Scotland. If I say single grain, you don't know what type of grain that is, but you know that it's from one single distillery. So here again, single means one distillery, and grain can be or will be a combination of different grain types. So not just malted barley, but also most probably wheat, corn, or other grains. Then you have the blend. You might have heard Scotch blend or blended Scotch or blended whiskey. So blend, as the name suggests, is from several distilleries and also from several grain types. If I say blended malt, then I already specify the grain type. So that would mean that it's from only 100% from malted barley, but it's from several distilleries. Then you have the bourbon. The bourbon is very typical for the US, or it's produced in the US, and it has to contain at least 51% corn. The rest can be anything. Mostly they will have a portion of barley and rye or even wheat. And then you have the rye whiskey. Again, that is more typical for the Northern America. When it comes to maturation, first thing that I have to mention that in order to be called whiskey, it has to be matured. So in the US, by law, it's 2 years at least, and in Scotland or in Ireland, it has to be at least 3 years. So before that, when you distill the alcohol, that's called the new make or new make spirit. You put the new make into wood casks, and after a couple of years, you can call it whiskey. Cask maturation. I will create a separate video on this topic. But right now, I just want to give you a couple of things that I also mentioned in video number 2. So back in the days, wood casks have been used in order to transport the whiskey and also to store the whiskey. So they primarily haven't been used to mature whiskey. You have to know that people have been drinking much more back in the days, like really a lot. And the whiskey didn't have time to mature, so they've been transporting it, they've been storing it in wood casks, but that's it. And by kind of a coincidence, and by enforcing a law roughly 100 years ago, the lawmakers, the government basically wanted to limit whiskey consumption. So they said that whiskey has to be matured at least for 3 years. So they wanted to delay the time until the whiskey gets arrives to the market. And by accident, people realized that, hey, if you leave whiskey for at least 3 years in the wood, it will taste better. So that's very interesting. This is why it is essential to understand and to know the history behind whiskey, because otherwise this whole industry and the whole spirit just won't make any sense to you. The oak cask, so the maturation gives roughly 60 or even 70% of the aromas and flavors. So nowadays you cannot even imagine producing whiskey without maturing for several years. And depending on the size of the cask, whether it's a smaller cask or a bigger cask, the type of the oak, so whether it's an American oak or European oak, and also the time of reuse of the cask, whether you use it just once or two times or three times, and also what was the previous content of the cask. Was that, for example, bourbon? Is that a new cask, or was it a wine or port or sherry that was the previous content of the cask? It will have a very different influence on your new make spirit. So every cask has a different dynamic, and the master distiller has to know which cask will be the best for his or her new make spirit. So this is really a science and also an art at the same time. And here I'm showing you a very, very nice chart from whisky.com. Feel free to pause the video. So here you see that when you distill the whiskey, it already has a very nice taste. This is the blue line. And in the first couple of years, the wood helps to subtract some of the unpleasant flavors from your new make spirit. And afterwards, slowly it starts to give flavors to your whiskey. And you don't want the cask to be too strong or to give too much flavors, but also so basically you want to get the optimal point where in years and also the taste of the new make spirit matches or they intersect, and that's the point where you will say that the whiskey is ready. I will come back to this point shortly. Now I want to mention a couple of mistakes that some people do. So for example, many people claim that, oh, you know, I just hate whiskey, I don't really like it. And I'm like, okay, have you ever tried a good whiskey? And they are like, well, not really. I tried this or that, but usually they are mentioning the cheapest blends or the cheapest bourbons. And I'm like, can you really judge a spirit by tasting the cheapest or the most widely available bottle? Not really. It's like buying a 2 euro wine and saying that, you know, I just hate wine because it tastes like crap. Also, many people rush it. So you really have to be patient when it comes to whiskey. You have to, you know, do your homework. And also when you pour it out, you have to let it sit. You have to let it open up a bit and read about the whole whiskey, you know. Ice. If you like it with ice, go ahead. I don't judge you. Everybody can drink his or her whiskey how they like it. I don't care. But if you really want to explore a whiskey, if you want to do it the proper way, then you don't drink it with ice. You drink it on room temperature and neat. Also, you might want to add a couple of drops of water, but I will come back to this in a second. Price ranges. I want to give you an idea how much a good bottle of whiskey costs. So anything below 30 is a bit problematic because I just mentioned beforehand, do you want to judge a spirit by drinking the cheapest one? So below 30, it's really hard to find acceptable or good bottles of whiskey. It's not impossible, but it's really challenging. Then the next range would be between 40 and 60. And this is where you can already buy very good whiskey. So the famous distilleries already have their core range, most of their core range in this area. So the 10-year or the standard 12-year-old whiskies will be available in this price range. If you are willing to go or spend an additional buck on top of this, then above 60 and up to 100, you will get excellent whiskies. So stuff that you see here, you can already buy between 60 and 100. And yes, I know this is already a lot of money, but you will get already fantastic whiskies. Between 100 and 200, that's getting tricky. And that's really where you have to know what you buy, because price and quality or taste is not necessarily linear. Until a point, yes, I would say until like 100 euros, yes, but above 100 euros, it will get really tricky. So you really have to know what you are buying. And above 200, it's more like about supply and demand. So when a bottle is really rare, or you know, you want to buy some old bottle in an auction, that's where the price will get really, really will skyrocket. But it won't mean that it's that much better. In fact, I could show you a whiskey that costs 300 euros and you won't like it that much as a 50 euros bottle, because as I said, it's not always, the relationship is not always linear. Here and now I want to give you some personal recommendations. When it comes to Irish whiskey, I think that the Jameson Black Barrel, that's already a good starting point in terms of Irish whiskies. It's really affordable. I think it's even below 30 euros. But if not, then you can go with the Green Spot, Yellow Spot or Red Spot. These are for the Midlothian Distillery. These are single pot Irish whiskies, so traditional Irish whiskies. Also, red breast 12 or red breast 15 year old are just classics. Very nice sherry maturation whiskies, so also very good entry level whiskies in every aspect. But also you can try Teeling single malt or Teeling single spot, and Waterford is already a bit more advanced, but I really enjoy that too. Bourbon, Maker Marks 46, Michters, they have bourbon and also rye. Or if you want to try a Tennessee whiskey, that's the Jack Daniels, and there go for the single barrel. Very good whiskeys, very good price quality ratio. Malt whiskeys, it's pretty hard to give you the standard ones, you know, because there are just so many. Scotland has over 120 different distilleries. So I'm just gonna pick you some names that I consider standard distilleries or where you could start, but it's just really super subjective, so feel free to check also others' opinion. So the Balvenie, Deanston, Glenmorangie, Oban or Tomatin distilleries are something that I would consider as entry-level whiskies or something that beginners can try. Then I always split whiskies into two big categories. One is the sherried whiskies and the other one the smoky whiskies. These are the trendy two big lines that whiskey connoisseurs always mention. So when it comes to sherried whiskies, go for Abelard, Glenfarclas, Glendronach, Glenfiddich, most of you will know it, or even Bunahaven. I think it's a very nice sherried whiskey. When it comes to smoky whiskey, I can highly recommend you a Talisker 10, a Legic 10, or a Kalila 12 year old. These are smoky whiskies, but not the smokiest out there. So feel free to go for that if you want to try a smoky whiskey. And if you want to try a hardcore smoky whiskey, then you have to go for the big names like Lefroy, Ardbeg or Lagavulin. My personal favorites, I have two distilleries that I like a lot. One is the Brookladdick distillery. They have three different segments. They have the unpeated one, so the Brookladdy. They have the Port Charlotte, that's the heavily peated. And then you have Octomore, which is the most heavily peated whiskey on earth. The second distillery is Springbank, where you have again the unpeated range, which is the Hazelburn. You have Springbank, which is the mildly peated expression, and you also have the Lungrow. And Springbank also owns Glengarry, that produces Kilkerran. So these are not beginners whiskey, but I think they can be really rewarding. So depending where you are in your journey, feel free to grab some of these bottles. When it comes to blends, blends are considered to be, you know, more like mass produced and not that good, but there are very good exceptions. For example, Compass Box. So if you want to try a good blend, go for this brand. Japanese and Canadian whiskey, I barely tried any of them, but on top of my head, I would suggest you go for Nikka. If you want to try Japanese whiskey, or in the Canadian region, you might want to try Glen Breton. In video number 4, I showed you how you should approach and how you should taste whiskey the proper way. So the first and most important step is that you have to pour it and you have to let it sit for a couple of minutes. There is a rule of thumb where you say 1 year in the cask is equal to 1 minute in the glass. First step is always that you look at your whiskey, you check the color, you check the viscosity, the appearance of the whole whiskey, you already start to appreciate what's in your glass. Second step is that you start to nose it by holding your glass like this, and you are just trying to pick up the aromas. By the way, you see that this is a Glencairn whiskey glass. This is considered to be the standard single malt whiskey glass. So you don't necessarily need this specific one, but the shape of the glass should be roughly like this. So you know appearance, nose, then you take a first sip and you check the mouthfeel. How is it? Is it oily? Can you get some of the flavors that you smelled on the nose? And the fourth step and the last step is once you swallow it, so it's the finish. And there you want to check again, do the aromas and flavors come through? Do you get the same stuff that you nosed? Is it long? Is it warm? How is it? You want to explore the whiskey. So this is the four-step process. This is like one big chunk. You can explore the whiskey properly this way. Once you taste it, feel free to add water, because once you add a couple of drops of water, it will help to open it up even more and open also new layers. So the whiskey might change, it might not change, it might change completely. So adding a couple of drops of water, it's really fun, especially with higher strength whiskeys, it can make it more palatable. And always make sure that you have some kind of guidance. Many times on the bottles, you will see what the distillery says, what can you find in this whiskey, or you just enter the website, or you just check reviews. And these reviews will help you to explore also those flavors, because at the beginning, it's extremely difficult to pick it up because there's just so many things going on. So you will need a guidance and practice. So be patient, know where the flavors come from. I just told you wood cask, house tar, and so on. And yeah, step by step, it will be a lot of fun, believe me. Yes, then starting from videos number 5 until video number 9, I've been exploring the biggest misconceptions that are out there. So in video number 5, I talked about the ABV topic, so the alcohol by volume topic. Many people think that every whiskey is bottled with 40% ABV, but thanks God that's not true. There are a lot of whiskeys that are bottled with a higher strength, so above 40%, and there is also there are a lot of whiskeys that are bottled with cask strength. So as the name suggests, they are not diluted back, they are bottled as they are in the cask. In video number 6, I talked about the single cask topic. So again, people think that whiskies are bottled straight from the barrel or straight from the cask, but that's a very exceptional thing. Most of the time they are wetted together. So the master distiller goes in and says that, okay, these 40 casks and those 20 casks and those 20 casks will be now wetted together and bottled. So this is how it's done. Single cask expressions are more expensive. Those are something more special. So now you heard this. Video number 7, I talked about the age statement topic or non-age statement topic. Why is that sometimes distilleries want to hide the age of the whiskey? So you have to understand that older whiskey doesn't necessarily mean that it's better. Depending what kind of cask you use and what's your main target, what do you want to achieve, the maturation profile and the dynamics will be completely different, okay? So if you want to produce or create a very old whiskey, using a fresh cask might give just too much flavors and you won't be able to have a very good whiskey because your spirit will be cooked within the cask. So something to keep in mind, that I could show you young whiskies that are so good, and if it would be a blind tasting, you would never tell which one is how many years old. So this is what I was exploring in video number 7. Then in number 8, I talked about the coloring, because in Scotland and in Ireland you are allowed to color your whiskey. I know, that's pretty shocking. So why is this allowed in the first place? So the law wants to give you the opportunity to even out the differences between the different batches. So one year it might happen that the casks the casks that you use are having a consist of whiskey that is a little bit darker in color or lighter in color, and between the different years, you have this possibility to even out these differences. Why is this the case? Because, you know, you don't want to confuse the average consumers, but you are not an average consumer anymore. You know that whiskey by design every year can have a different color, and that's more than fine. You should be very happy. You don't want to have the constant whiskey for every single year. But of course, not everyone knows this. So many distilleries unfortunately use additional coloring, and some do not use it to even out the differences, but to, you know, completely make the whiskey darker, because psychologically there is a thing that people who do not know anything about whiskey and go into a store and want to buy something will automatically pick one that it's more darker. And this is why, you know, if you make a darker whiskey, it might appeal to a wider range of people. But again, color is not indicative, so it doesn't mean anything if your whiskey is darker, and especially if you can color it. Yeah, you get it now. Topic number nine, video number nine was about chill filtration. So you have this picture in your mind where someone is sitting there and enjoying a whiskey in a huge tumbler with a lot of ice in it. It can happen that when you put ice in your whiskey, it will get cloudy. It will get a bit blurry. And the average consumer can get really confused. Hey, I put ice in my whiskey. What's happening here? And there is a method that you can apply during the production process where you can eliminate this effect. So the distillery can decide, can filter out the components that make the whiskey hazy and blurry. This is called chill filtration. They cool down the whiskey, they filter out some of the components, and they bottle it. And once these components are filtered out and you put ice or water into your whiskey, it will stay crystal clear. But as your stomach suggests you are filtering out part of the whiskey, and this is not a good thing. So ideally, you want a whiskey that is bottled with a bit higher strength. If you want something special, you can go for some single cask expressions, but if you're a beginner, that doesn't make too much sense. Age is important, but age is not everything. Coloring, try to go for natural colors, so coloring-free whiskies, and also whiskies that are not chill filtered. Yes. So to sum up and some final remarks, whiskey is much more than alcohol, okay? It's culture, it's history, it's heritage. It has a community building power, and it has such a big history, and you know, every bottle tells you a different story. And there are so many things to explore. It's just so exciting. Once you find, you know, joy in exploring the aromas and flavors, because whiskey tasting is all about exploring the taste and the smell, you know. It's not about getting drunk. It's not about drinking. It's really about exploring the wide range of flavors that is available. So, yeah. This is how I consider whiskey. This is why it became a hobby of mine roughly 3 years ago. Yeah, so it's science and art at the same time. And this is why I find it really, I'm really passionate about this topic, because it really, it's a really nice free time activity. We are living in a world that it's really busy. We are always running. We are, you know, we are getting so many inputs every single day, and I work in finance, and especially there's, you know, work longing hours, very intense days, and it's just really good to sometimes sit down, sip a whiskey, have a good time, explore it. It really gives me a peace of mind, and it's just a huge universe that I didn't know it existed, and now that I discovered every single day, it's just so good. I enjoy the tastings, I enjoy to organize tasting, I enjoy to talk about this. There's a very nice community out there. So I really hope that I made you also curious about these topics if you weren't beforehand. And yeah, welcome again to this channel. Please subscribe if you like it. There is much more to come. I will release every 2 or 3 weeks new videos on different topics, including reviews. So I'm happy to catch you in the new videos. So stay tuned and take care. Bye bye.